four great walls and four great towers overlook a space of flowers and the silent island bows the lady of Shalash. Only reapers reaping yearly in among the beaded. By the moon, the reaper weary, piling sheaves in uplands arid, listening whispers, tears the fairy, the lady of Shalash. She weaves by night and day a magic web with colors gay. She has heard a whisper say a curse is on her if she stayed to look down to Camelot. She knows not what the curse may be, and so she weaves steadily. Little other hath she, the lady of Shalott. Moving through a mirror clear, there hangs before her all the year. Shadows of the world appear. There she sees the highway near, winding down to Camelot. And sometimes through the mirror, the knights come riding two and two. She hath no loyal knight and true, the lady of Shalott. But in her web she still delights to weave the mirror's magic sights. For often through the silent nights, a funeral with plumes and with lights and music. Overhead came two young lovers lately wed. I'm half sick of shadows, she said, the lady of Shalott. Shot from her bodies, he rode between the barley sheaves. The sun came dancing through the leaves and flanked upon the rising greens of Bordas and Lancelot. A red cross knight forever kneeled to a lady in his shield. Sparkled on the yellow field beside remote Shalott. His broad clear brow in sunlight glowed, on burnished hooves his war horse trod. From underneath his helmet glowed his coal black curls as on he rode, as he rode out to Camelot. From the bank from the river, he flashed into the crystal mirror. Tira lira by the river, silence lands about. She left the web, she left the moon. She made three paces through the room. She saw the water lily bloom. She saw the helmet on. She looked down to Camelot. Out through the web and floated wide, the
the storm east wind straining, the pale yellow woods were waning, the broad stream in his vines complaining, heavily the low sky riding over towered command. Down she came and found a boat beneath a willow left afloat, round about the prow she wrote the Lady of Shalott. Down the river's dim expanse, like some bold sirena trance, seeing on his own mischance, with a glassy countenance she looked to come. At the closing of the day, she loosed the chain, down she lay, the broad stream bore her far away, the Lady of
So that wasn't that the one I was after either. I think that was interesting for a whole variety of reasons. It's beautiful though, right? It's stunning. What's really interesting is how, so the one version was the 1832 version, which is the original that Tennyson wrote. And the second is an 1842 version, which I think is the one that's in your books. And the 1842, the conclusion is very different from the 1832. There's a few points of divergence. And there are other versions of this as well, I will add. But the conclusion going from they cross themselves. So this is the people in Camelot. They see the body come in, float in. The stars, they bless the knight, the minstrel, abbot, squire, and guest. There lay a parchment on her breast that puzzled more than all the rest, the well-fed wits at Camelot. So these are the scholars of Camelot, and they look upon the parchment, and then quote, the quote is from presumably the parchment. The web was woven curiously, the charm is broken utterly, draw near and fear not. This is I, the Lady of Shalott. So the parchment reveals who she is, on because she's still dead. But the parchment is written by her. So she's written a note revealing who she is and talking about the web being having a curious weave and the charm having been broken. Whereas here, the poem concludes with a question of who this is. And the cheer dies, they cross themselves for fear, and Lancelot, as opposed to the wits, is the one who speaks, and he recognizes who it is, and he himself speaks, she has a lovely face, God in his mercy lend her grace, the Lady of Shalott. Now he knows who it is, because the prow of the boat has the Lady of Shalott on it, but that could just be the name of the boat, and have nothing to do with the woman inside, but he connects that. So it's very different. Lancelot speaks at the end, in the one, and in the other, it's the Lady of Shalott speaking, but not actually directly speaking. The parchment that's on her dead breast is what they read. And that's, so it's a very different ending. Let's look at the commonalities of the poem rather than focus on the ending. We'll come to the ending, and I want to note really a lot of things that are of significant interest in the poem. One is that it lends itself to song. It wasn't written as a song, but it certainly lends itself to song. And one of the, and I think you can agree with that, it fits very well, is because of the regularity of the meter and the rhyme. It's extraordinarily regular. And when I say rhyme, it's quite the rhyme. Look at the rhyme. It's A, 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 A. Same thing here. B, well, we'll put the B here. Camelot, Shalott, or B, and then we'll have C, C, C. So these will rhyme, but so will these, and then the four at the beginning. So the regularity of the rhyme scheme is quite marked. The other thing about it is that the meter is iambic tetrameter. When I say iambic tetrameter, there are 4 feet that go of this, they're unstressed and then stressed 4 times on either side the river lie. Right, you can hear it. The stress is on either side, riv, and lie. That regularity in which there's an emphasis on every second syllable is consistent. Now, iambic tetrameter tends to be used in most hymns. There's a strong sense of order in it because there are 2 metrical feet on one side and 2 on the other. So it has a balance to it. So one of the meters that you will know from studying Shakespeare in school and so forth is iambic pentameter. Mm-hmm. But pentameter, the number 5, it can't divide in half. It's sort of 2 on one side and 3 on the other. So it doesn't lend itself to music in the same way, whereas tetrameter does. And so most hymns, if you ever sing them, are written in tetrameter because it is more harmonious. And so it lends itself to that. The other thing about it is the rhyme, which also lends itself to music. It's a very musical work. Even before it's put to music, it has that quality of music. And the rhyme gives it that. Now, the other thing about rhyme is that we associate rhyme with a sort of an enchantment. I think nursery rhymes and so forth, they're telling of something in the past that may have a sort of universal truth to it, the wisdom of the ancients, and yet we don't necessarily take those nursery rhymes, for instance, to be telling us a true account of something that happened in the past. Like, where did Cinderella live, and where was Snow White? And at what time did this happen? Nobody asks those questions because we know that it's not meant to convey that sort of, it's not a historical account. But nonetheless, it does have some sort of truth to life to it, and that's its archetypal significance, I guess. But by presenting it in that form here, he is presenting it almost as a myth. And the rhyme scheme adds to it, so much so that when most of you come to university, or at least I did, I thought that poetry and rhymed verse were more or less the same thing. You expect rhyme in poetry, and if it doesn't have rhyme, it's not very good poetry. Like, you forgot the rhyme bit. Put that back in. The other thing I want you to note about this is the strong, and we're going to see this in when we look down, is there's this antithesis, or at least a parallelism being drawn between Camelot and Shalott. Both are rhymed, and the other is that the line shortened to trimeter rather than tetrameter, to many towered Camelot, to many towered Camelot. Actually, that's what I'm talking about. That is actually a tetrameter. Whereas roundabout Shalott is not. Never mind. But Camelot and Shalott are repeated over and over here. So I will demonstrate. We move down to the next line, and we will find the same thing. Isn't that clever? Oops, didn't fit. Almost. Right? Camelot, Shalott, Camelot, Shalott, Camelot, Shalott. Over and over. So we have two places. There are two locations. One of them for Tennyson and his age, a place of great interest, Camelot, where King Arthur and his knights were said to have resided. For Tennyson, who is the poet laureate of Britain at the time, Camelot would have had all of the resonances of an age of chivalry and a time of peace in Britain and a time in which Christian virtue was to some degree triumphing over paganism. The story of Arthur and his knights gets Christianized, certainly when we saw in Sir Gawain and the Green Knight. Sir Gawain was one of the knights of the Round Table, but there's all sorts of different romances related to that. But this, and so the question that they have is, how do we British relate to that original myth? Is it a myth or is it a true history, first of all? It's one of the questions. And I think there was an intense period of questioning, and to this day I think it persists to some degree, whether King Arthur and his knights did actually live, and if they did, where they were to be found. And I think by and large most scholars are in agreement now that there was such a figure. I might be wrong in saying that. I shouldn't use the word most, let's say some. And that it was probably in the southwest of England, if not in Wales. And then the time frame, not exactly up on my Arthuriana, but sometime like the 5th century. And so famous was he that the lays, the songs and stories of King Arthur and his knights were told also in France, what we now call France, which is often the British and the French were often ruled by French kings, English kings, both, and so it was often, it went back and forth for a long time. And so those stories about King Arthur are often told in French, even though the king was not in France. So that is another feature of the poem, this Camelot Shalott, and it keeps on doing this, Camelot Shalott, Camelot Shalott, Camelot Shalott, and again, until at this point, she says, I'm not going to get that right there, I am half sick of shadows, said the Lady of Shalott. So she's in that, I'll go through it in more detail in a second. And at that point, right at that point, Enter Sir Lancelot. Or he won't stay there. But now Camelot has been replaced for the first time by someone who represents Camelot, except now we have a man. And we not only have a man, but we have the first knight of Camelot. And we've just heard from the Lady of Shalott, she's half sick of shadows. And now a man enters the scene for the first time. But then it goes back to Camelot Shalott. Camelot Shalott, Camelot Shalott. And then we get this. Camelot, Sir Lancelot. He's come right into where Shalott was. Now Sir Lancelot has, as it were, not physically, but in the heart of the Lady of Shalott, come right into her venue. And at that point, when he sings, and she sees him in the mirror, now she left the web, she left the loom, she made three paces through the room, she saw the water lily flower bloom, she saw the helmet and the plume. She is an anaphore. She looked down to Camelot, which she was not supposed to do. The curse is now broken, right? And at that point, the turning point in the story, because she's now done the thing that was cursed. But I just wanted to draw to your attention those moments when the repetition is broken. And so this is what having a regular or expected rhyme scheme or theme, it does. It leads you to expect it. And so when it changes, you notice the changes, and it's significant that it changes. Whereas if you have no pattern or order to your writing, then the changes are just ordinary. It's not a change, which is the normal pattern of things, isn't really change anymore. It's just stasis. You see the point. Now it will be replaced in a different way. It's Camelot and Shalott, but now it's that's the name of the ship she's on. It's called the Lady of Shalott. She writes it on the prow, and it floats down, and she's dead in it, and that's how they know who it is. Stupid geese, yeah. Camelot, Shalott, Camelot, Shalott, and then down to the end, and then we saw occasionally it's the name of the boat as well, the whole of that, but again, it stays there till the end, the Camelot, Shalott, other than in this version. No, in this version it's exactly the same. But it's the speaker and so forth. But so you can see that regularity in the poem as well, and it's quite striking. And it only breaks at a couple of points, but the points at which it breaks are highly significant for the story of the poem. Now, one of the questions that is going to be raised here in the poem, I talked about the legend and reality, is the nature of story. And what happens in artistic story? Now, there's a couple of things I want to draw to your attention on this. Let's see if I can find. Oh my goodness.
I thought they cursed out or something.
They live here. They come back every year to the same place. And they always make this noise. And it just...
It's spring.
It's spring.
According to who?
The geese.
The geese are telling you. So there it is.
I think they're just complaining because they were told it was spring and they got here and they're unhappy because it's not.
And where is else is the lady? I'm going to have to put the Lady of Shalott.
Yeah, they're playing her.
No! We're not playing her. No, thank you.
So here are some different images. All of these are of the Lady of Shalott, and I'd hoped would be in that video that I showed you. Sort of. So that one you saw.
Yeah.
This is also the Lady of Shalott. But the one that I would probably draw your attention to is this one. Yeah, maybe for just a sec. But it's not very big. There must be a bigger version of it. There we go. That's better. So, and this one's quite useful because it demonstrates what's going on, because she's at a loom and she's weaving. And she's weaving by looking into a mirror. So let's just say that this is the mirror, because it is the mirror. The mirror is behind her. She looks into the mirror, and then she weaves on the loom what she sees in the mirror, and the mirror reflects what's in the window behind her, but she dares not look out the window. She only looks at the mirror, which reveals what's behind her, and then she portrays what she sees in the mirror. So it's not saying something about the artistry. Now, if you recall from last semester, we looked at Plato's Allegory of the Cave. Do you remember that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, tell me something about it then.
It's like a distortion of what it actually is.
Yes, so according to Plato at any, at
yeah.
Plato at any rate, Allegory of the Cave. So it's book 7 of the Republic, and Plato says, gives this story, or an allegory. And in this story, there are prisoners that are chained, and they look at the wall of a cave. I'll erase this. The cave is over here, and it opens upwards, and the prisoners are, let's say they're on chairs here, and their faces are here, and they're sitting down on the chairs, and they're bound, so they have to look this way at the wall of the cave, and there are the sun up here is casting its light down here, and there is a some sort of a theater or a spectacle here on a, they're walking, it's going across the platform, and so it throws shadows onto the wall. And these gentlemen who are chained to these chairs look at the wall, and they never see anything but shadows. That's what they look at. And then they talk amongst themselves about what's going on the shadows, in the shadows. And that, oh, this happened and this happened. They hear all sorts of strange voices, but they agree on what reality is. They agree on what reality is. And then Plato says, let's suppose that one of them were dragged out of the cave into the sunlight. First of all, their eyes, they'd be totally blinded because they've been in the dark their whole lives. But now they're going to see, and they're going to see that the shadows that they once saw portrayed were nothing like as real or vivid or actual or real as what they saw out in the daylight. And he said, this is what philosophy does. It takes people out in the daylight so they see things as they really are, as opposed to the way they imagine them to be. Whereas the poets imagine that the world is as they see the shadowy depiction of it. And then they write it down. So they represent something that they are imitating, but what they're imitating isn't the reality either. So it's at a third remove from reality. So says Plato in the Allegory of the Cave. And for which reason, he says, the poets ought to be banished from his ideal republic because they don't know what they're talking about. It ought to be philosophers that are running the show because they deal with things as they really are, rather than fictions that they invent. And Plato has in mind probably the way the gods are portrayed in... can you put the light back? Thanks. The gods are portrayed as being immoral beings. They steal, they lie, they cheat. They seem to act like grown-up children, except they're immortal other than that, but they have no... They're bad people. They're not just... they're not just like people, they're bad people at that. This cannot be the way the gods truly are. So when she is weaving in her loom, she is an artist looking at the mirror and depicting what she says. Now her depiction isn't as accurate as this, so this is a misrepresentation of a misrepresentation of the real reality. Furthermore, the web that she's weaving on the loom draws back to mind what we saw in the Odyssey about Penelope. Remember Penelope, when she has the suitors that want to marry her, and she says, I will marry one of you as soon as I finish this tapestry, this which I'm weaving for my father-in-law. Once he dies, he's going to need this, and they think, oh, well, that's a good woman, of course, so we'll let you do this, and she deceives them. So, oh, what a tangled web we weave when first we practice to deceive, based on Penelope. So the idea of having of weaving is thereafter connected with deceit. Further add a little complexity to this. This may sound overly clever, but the Latin word textum, from which we get the word text, we use to this day, a textum is something woven. Literally. So when we talk about a text, you have text, we're reading from the text, the Lady of Shalott, this is something that's been woven together by the artist. It's probably referring not to the artistry, but more the material on which you would write, like a papyrus was threads woven together to be something you would write on, right? If you look at old, so it's threads being woven together and that. But it's also referring to the stories, or it could be taken to refer to the stories, if stories or fiction is said to be untrue, just like Penelope. And then you have the great antithesis between the realist or the scientific-minded and the artist or the liars. So that he's playing on this in this story, and he's drawing on a rich tradition of discussion of that. Question or comment? It might. It might. But I'm not sure that he's reflecting on that here or not. So Shakespeare says that, and in this he reflects upon the classical understanding of what art is. It is mimesis, or the representation of reality. But note that it's of reality. Plato's out on a limb when he suggests that poets are not depicting reality. He's out on a limb there. He is not within the, and some have never been able to understand, let alone believe, that Plato meant what he said about the artists here. Because he himself uses stories throughout his own philosophical texts. And it's hard to believe, and certainly Aristotle thinks that the poet and the philosopher have a strong common ground. And the tradition of mimesis is the representation of reality, and it's holding up the mirror to nature as 'twere to show her true self. It's not just depicting things as you see them, it's the essence of the thing, the nature of the nature. So that would be the artistic tradition, but that doesn't seem what she's doing. She seems to be living in a shadow world, and it's a world in which she's trapped and can't get out of, and it's like a prison. So I think more it's less that than more Plato, and more malign than that, and then she dies as a result of it, and she's heard a whisper say, where did the whisper come from? Did she imagine the whisper? If she only imagined it, then why does she die? Like, what kills her? She's heard the curse is on her if she should look out the window. She goes to the window, looks out, and not only does she die, but the web flies out the window after her. The mirror cracks from side to side, and the web flies out the window. Yes?
So, is the mirror that she has, like the fictional reality she has, a reflection of a view of history, believing myths?
Well, so that's the question. What does the mirror represent then in this? And what is this? So the text may represent the depiction, the artist's depiction. What does the mirror represent, though? Yeah.
Because in believing this myth or curse, I guess, in believing this kind of curse that's on her, she's accepting that what she sees in the mirror is reality until she turns around.
She is, and yet part of her isn't, because she's believing that if she should turn around, she's heard a whisper say a curse is on her. She believes that, seemingly. So go back to, this is another one where she's peering out the window. And that's a bad version of one of the earlier ones. That's a better one. So let me go back to the poem itself. Oh, by the way, right at the outset. There are those who have also heard her. And who are they? The reapers, the commoners, out working at night, so late and early, and they hear her singing happily, cheerily, like an angel, singing clearly. So the common folk still believe the old myths. We can hear her in the morning. We can hear her in the evening. She is that in that tower, that's where the Lady of Shalott lives. It's maybe an abandoned tower, maybe there's nothing there, but the common folk believe that there is a lady up there and she sings. And they're the only ones that hear, because the burghers, that is the citizens of Camelot, they don't believe it. So something's being said about here even further about what the civilized people think, people who live in cities think, and people who live in the country think. And folk myths. There's also a commentary on that. Any rate, so she is going down there, and the Lady of Shalott. And she is, no time hath she to sport and play, a charmed web she weaves alway. A curse is on her if she stay her weaving, either night or day to look down to Camelot. So if she stops weaving, a curse is on her. If she stops weaving, so this, it's, if you want to think of the web as a form of deceit, the person most being deceived is she. She can't stop doing it. Nobody sees the web except her. Yes.
So her looking out the window isn't part of the curse.
No, it's the stopping. If she stay her weaving, either night or day, to look down. So it's a little ambiguous. It's a little bit of both. If she stops to do that, is it because she stops or because she does that? That's why she can't stop.
Yeah, that's why she can't look.
Okay. Right. That's why she can't look. But is it the curse because she goes to look or because she stops? It doesn't really matter. But I think it does, actually. It's when she looks out. That's when it breaks, because at that point she now knows what I'm weaving is a mere representation of what's in the mirror, and the mirror wasn't nearly as attractive as, whoa, there's Lancelot, because he's there and he's Tira Lira singing whatever song that means. Now that she's seen the real, she can't go back to her, that's the point. Now that she's looked out at Lancelot, she's not going to go back to pretending and imagining what it must be like to have a man of her own, because that's what she... So she knows not what the curse may be, and she weaves steadily. She lives with little joy or fear. With either. So it's a gray life. It's a murky, it's a shadowy life, a shadowy existence. There's not any highs, there are also no lows. That's what she lives in. Sometimes she hears... Sometimes a troop of damsels glad, or an abbot on an ambling pad, sometimes a curly shepherd lad, or a long-haired page in crimson clad goes by. And she, sometimes the knights come riding to, and her thought, she hath no loyal knight and true, the Lady of Shalott. So a wistful, a sense of missing something. Until the point when she hears music come from Camelot, or when the moon was overhead, the moon, a symbol of madness, by the way, here as ever in literature, it's a symbol of change as well, because the moon waxes and wanes. Lunacy, from lune, the word moon, she says to herself, I am half sick of shadows. She's aware. She's stuck to her task, her sticking to her knitting, as it were. But now she's losing a sense of delight in it. And at that point, Lancelot enters the scene. Now, what I want you to note here as well is there is a bit of a parallelism between Lancelot and Shalott and the Lady of Shalott. So she's always looking at her loom or at the mirror and then replicating it in the loom. But he forever kneeled to a lady in his shield. So, and if you remember Sir Gawain and the Green Knight, the inside of Sir Gawain's shield was who? Do you remember? Mary, the Blessed Virgin Mary, is on the inside of his shield. So on the outside, there is that pentangle, the scarlet pentangle. But on the inside, he looks at the... And when he is in a place of temptation or danger for encouragement, he looks to the lady inside the shield. So he looks to her and draws comfort from the knowledge that she loves him, etc. And so he is also looking not at the world. So when there's danger, he's not looking at the danger, he's looking at the lady. And he's doing it forever. So he also is holding on to he has a faith, as it were, in what he's looking at, as opposed to the world as it actually is. So there's a parallelism going on between the Lady of Shalott and Sir Lancelot. At the point at which she... sings, he rides down from Camelot, and from the bank and from the river he flashed into the crystal mirror, tira lira, tira lira, sang Sir Lancelot. At that point she then departs from the web. So when he sings finally, she doesn't just see him in the mirror, she hears him singing. So it's not something she's imagining, she hears the voice. And now she knows there is someone there. It's not just he looks really good in the mirror, I'm just imagining, because she could think she's never looked out. She's longed for a knight true to her. She is so desirous of it that she may believe that she's imagining that there he is in the mirror, and then she hears his voice sing, and that's it. Flip, turn around, run to the window. Sees the water flower bloom and sees the helmet and the plume on his helmet, and she looks down to Camelot and realizes it's not just my imagination. There is such a place. Out flew the web and floated wide. The mirror cracked from side to side. The curse has come upon me, cried the Lady of Shalott. Now the curse is one she brings upon herself by her own actions. But how do we know she's cursed, other than that she believes the curse? Why she believed the curse? Right, so those might be good signs of it, right? Exactly, there's empirical evidence for the fact that she's cursed. Because her former way of life is no longer open to her. The mirror doesn't work, and the web that she was weaving is gone. But note, the web that she was weaving was for herself. It was for her benefit. It was her narrative. Her narrative is now shattered by the reality of life around her. She can't believe it anymore. How about Lancelot with his lady? The implicit comparison the reader may make. This is an age not only when there's the great expansion of the British Empire and industrialization, there's also a great loss of faith in Christianity amongst the British, particularly amongst the intellectuals. And particularly when Darwin writes Origin of the Species, there is probably a bit of a trickle becomes an avalanche in terms of even the clergy. But certainly amongst the clerisy, which Coleridge talks about, the clerisy by which we, these days we would use the word intellectuals. Coleridge laments in the 1920s that there's a clerisy that have departed from conviction in Christian truth. Amongst the clerisy, not the clergy, but there's a certain type of individual. Some of them will be the clergy, not all of them. So this is happening long before Darwin steps on the stage. And And that itself is interesting. And when Darwin comes along and says, ha, we've got proof, you know, everyone feels that they are justified in this position and they throw themselves to it. But I think the loss of faith precedes the scientific discovery. But that's slightly off topic. Yes?
So would you think that they're comparing this web she's weaving to Christianity?
That's what I'm wondering. I'm wondering if there's some sort of an analogy being drawn up. It's being drawn up by the fact that he is looking at the lady in his shield all the time. So again, if you think about Tennyson, Tennyson is, I don't know, it'll be London Camelot, London Camelot, London Camelot, because Camelot is the place of mythical significance. Is it real? Is it not? In the story here, we have Shalott in Camelot, and the representation of London is Lancelot. And they're uncertain of whether the Lady of Shalott is just a mythological figure. Like, what is her... the educated people don't believe there's anybody there, but the common people believe there is somebody up in the tower. They hear her singing. What happens to her when she embraces reality is she loses the reality which she was in, and she dies. And the fiction's over. It's been dispelled. Again, it's... There's a whole series of questions that come up from this. One is, what is Tennyson actually saying in the poem? But also, what is the purpose of the story? Is it just to tell a beautiful story, or is he actually trying to say something? It is certainly the case that in the Victorian era, there is a widespread loss of faith in Christ, in part because of various accounts which are circulating, not just the science, but those that are disputing that the Bible is the word of God and so forth. So there are lives of Jesus being written by folks in this day that are gaining great credibility. The so-called quest for the historical Jesus, did he actually exist? Can we trust the accounts that have been written in the Gospels and so forth? And there's a departure quite widespread amongst the clerisy, which persists amongst the liberal establishment to this day, and even liberal Christians. So that story that the Gospels are unreliable, that they're myths, effectively, that have been told about the past, and the myths, for liberal Christians, there's something mythically true about the past, but it's not historically true. These events did not happen. When we talk about the virgin birth and the death and the resurrection of Christ, this is a story, and it may have mythological significance, but it's not a literal event in history. It's a story that's being told. So that's, I think, where this is going. It's a commentary on that. And to some degree, the question is, as I said, what do we do? What is Tennyson saying with this story? Because the Lady of the Shalott dies. Sir Lancelot keeps on looking at his lady, and in the end he looks at this lady at the end. No, that's the second version. And says she has a lovely face, but he just sees her as a literal figure, and he seems undisturbed in his well-being. And again, the ending, the variation in the endings is quite significant to what you think the story means then. But what are we to derive from the story of the Lady of Shalott? About art, about religion, about the importance of stories, about the relation between fiction and truth, because to this day we have two types of literature, at least. There's something called fiction, and then there's nonfiction, right? And the fiction is the stories that aren't true, and the nonfiction are the stories that are true, correct? So fiction and making, or write, or weaving, or making texts, are considered to have nothing to do with truth. So these are complicated issues. Adding to that, there's the so-called fact-value distinction. So that the processes of science delivers us facts, which we can verify and repeat, and the anything related to matters of beauty or goodness are subjective. So we can verify empirical things like natural objects. We can quantify them. Whereas it is said in this era, belief in the reality of goodness and such matters, these are subjective opinions. They're values that we place on it, but they don't have any objective standing. So there's an erosion of morality that comes from the Enlightenment, and I think Tennyson's talking about that here as well. Any comments or questions about this? I think it's an endlessly fascinating text. Yes. I think he is saying that. Remember, it's a poet writing it, and I think he's talking about the importance of stories, even if they're not true. That I think that's really, and that's more or less the Victorian position, is yes, we no longer believe the historical, literal truth of this, but we think nonetheless that we should hold on to those old stories because they're meaningful in some way. But they don't meet the bar of historical accuracy, but they are true in some sort of sense. In an archetypal sense, maybe like Jordan Peterson's talking about now, they have some. There's a really important universal sense, but it's not that sort of sense.
Like, I noticed that when they're talking about beauty and goodness, when they try to undermine beauty and goodness by saying it's subjective and there's so many different accounts of it, you're going to find really quickly that when they start going for universals or foundational logic, there's circular reasoning that's either
constantly
testing or self-defeating very quickly.
So, C.S. Lewis writes on this. I just gave a talk out in Calgary on this topic as well. He says that and he's talking about progressive evolution, the idea that evolution gives progress. He said that there's some psychological reasons why people give credence to this. One is because it, and he doesn't use the words, but there's a sort of a sadomasochism to it. There's a sadistic element and there's a masochistic element. So the sadistic element is that they will take any virtue and just say, virtues, good characteristics, are really not virtues. They're merely survival instincts. So the reason that people act virtuously is not because there is anything good or that they are good, but it's a survival instinct for them. Or the love poetry that we see throughout much of literature and so much of life depends on is merely a survival instinct. We talk about love because it preserves our and gives us a venue where our, you know, sub-rational urges can be worked out, but it's really just lust. It's not love. There's no difference between lust and love. On the one hand, so they'll denigrate everything that is high. At the same time, they'll explain away everything that is base. So they'll say that yes, people did evil and atrocious things in the past, but we are now, we've learned from that, and we're progressing away from that, and through education, we will no longer hold to the things that divided us. So the ideas of truth and beauty and goodness that divided people, we're now evolving into something that goes beyond that. So there's a sort of sadomasochistic leveling thing. So everything that is really high, we're going to bring down, and everything that's really low, we're going to explain away and bring up. So there's a leveling effect. And I think that that's here as well. So there's an intuitive awareness in the Victorian era that even if the gospel stories and biblical truth that transformed their nation is not true, it still needs to be held on to because it prevents the erosion of public morality that would ensue and the devastation that would come if it were abandoned. And I think that's what is being talked about today is we don't believe Christianity, but you know what, if it goes, the world is going to end. And that's being said by non-Christian thinkers and awareness. Do you know this is a hedge of protection? It has great value on many fronts, even if we don't. And that's Tennyson's position, more or less. It's not my position, but that's, I think, the common Victorian. Yes?
Kind of going back to the question before that one.
Okay.
interpretation is that we should keep believing. I'm wondering how that could be the interpretation when her act of stopping to leave seems like it's the heroic part of the poem. Like that seems like that's a good thing in the poem, in a sense. Like she goes out there, she gets her boat, she goes to Camelot, that's the action.
Yes. And we are sympathetic to the action, furthermore, I think. I mean, she's the heroine, and she's sick of the shadows, and they're called shadows, and she recognizes them as such. So I agree with you. I this is not an easy poem, and I don't think it comes, there's no unambiguous reading of it. There, for every reading, there is another side, but from the other side, it seems to be suggesting exactly what you've just said. So I still, having taught this now for 15 years, this poem, I still don't know what the poem means, because it's both.
Is that why he made two versions?
Maybe. He kept many, but the versions don't change those basic things. It still is ambiguous. He's saying on the one hand...
Well, on the one hand, she gets recognized as beautiful by this guy, but, you know, that's the reason she left the...
Yeah, it's only when she's dead.
But it doesn't matter.
It's true love.
Essence of it, right? Oh,
okay.
Whereas in the other one, it's like the scholars.
Yes.
And sort of reality.
Lay a parchment on her breast.
You know.
And the parchment puzzled more than all the rest, though. Note that. So this is the version that are here. The parchment puzzled them more than anything else because it suggests that there was such a lady.
Yeah.
And they thought it was just a story made up, but now they've got her with this on her breast, and it, the reason that she's there is because the web was woven curiously, the charm is broken utterly, so you don't need to be afraid. That's what she says to them now. So you don't need to be afraid. And they said, but now we are afraid because we thought that that was only story, and we see that there was such a person. But now it's over. So now they're afraid for different reasons, whereas in this one, a little different, and again, this is the later version, which tends to be in the anthologies. Yes.
In this one here, if you're talking about Sir Lancelot at the end.
Yep.
They're kind of saying like all the knights, and then it kind of just like a girl, and then but Sir Lancelot. Could he understood who she was because he also was like a figure?
So again, so very, so all the knights, they're afraid, but Lancelot is different than the rest of the knights. He draws near. And he muses a little bit, so he thinks about it a bit. And he says, she has a lovely face. Just like, I guess, the Virgin Mary has a lovely face that he's looking at. Can he only admire a woman when she's not alive? I mean, I'm wondering if Tennyson is suggesting that. Like, he didn't see her before, she saw him. I don't know how...
Well, she's pure, she's a virgin.
Yes, so... Yeah, so there's a lot of strangeness going on there, and I don't have the answer to your questions. I really don't. Did you want to? No, okay. So let me leave it at that.
So is it about dispelling myths, or?
So that was my question to you to write an essay on. Is it about dispelling myths or the danger of dispelling myths?
So for them, the danger of dispelling the myth is that the myth was actually true and you just dispelled it and now you've given the truth versus dispel this myth because it's not true.
Because it's not true. But there's a danger even in dispelling an untrue myth is what Tennyson seems to be suggesting.
Or staying in a place of never knowing if you don't try.
Right. Also. So he's hedging his bets.